Now do it again to the second neighbor. Out, first out. Give it to yourself. And then give it to your neighbor. Second neighbor. There we go. Have we got all that?
Yes.
Now, what about the third neighbor? Come back out first.
Give it to yourself.
And then give it to the third neighbor. Talk about intentionality. Wow.
One of the things actually that Gord Miller explained to me was that when they created the EBR, the internet was new, really, and so they didn't realize the power of the tools and how powerful people being able to access all this information online was going to be. And so once people started to use it, it became this institution that would never be shut down because so many people use it and access it because it was built with so much online kind of access.
Right.
It's pretty interesting.
Unless they shut the internet down, which is already in the plans. There's plans for internet too already.
Right. Okay.
So, but we'll see.
The Environmental Bill of Rights,
yes.
You were saying that nothing can ever touch that. But Harper's government has touched some legislation that people didn't think was touchable through new pools and things like that. So
he certainly amended something, hasn't he, or strived to amend something. Well, I mean, I'm not a lawyer, and I'm not a legislator at all. I doubt it. It's possible it could be amended. What could happen? I don't know. Could it be weakened? Could an appointee be a very, industry affiliated appointee? Could the environmental commissioner not be a Gord Miller? Absolutely. On the other hand, maybe even the first commissioner, Eva Leggetti, was different. I'm not familiar with her work, but I know she didn't dig as deep as Gord did. But at the same time, Gord is pretty incredible in that he, with a background with the ministry, with a background in mining, being from Northern Ontario, really understanding the industry needs. Now, he gets invited to speak to, for instance, the Good Roads Association, the Ontario Sand and Gravel Association. He gets invited to speak to all the industry players because he gets along that well with them, even though he calls everybody on the problems that he sees. So he's walking a very, very fine
tightrope.
Yeah, and it's quite brilliant. I think that finding somebody with that level of skill might be hard, and I think, of course, even who the commissioner is going to play a part in how it's utilized. So there we go. And again, I said we have a staff of 24. And keep on trucking. A little bit of history of the EBR. So it did come in 1994, and it was created under a NDP government. And I believe it was Ruth Greer was the Minister of the Environment at the time. And they first tried to do some sort of task force. They had this big committee of like 40 people, and apparently it was a total failure. It was too difficult to try and get all these different players and Aboriginal groups walked away. They said, this is going to undermine our very belief systems. We can't believe, first of all, land ownership, and that would take away some of the just rights that they assume being Aboriginal. But once they moved away from that, they went to a task force, and there were industry and government and environmental groups all in play. And it took a couple years before it was, they created a draft bill in 1992, and another year or so later, and it was finally created into law. So I was going to say here, the fight for the EBR was going on since the 1970s, really. Groups like the CELA, Environmental Law Association, and CELAP, and Pollution Probe, they were all trying to get an EBR going. So it took well over 20 years to make it happen. And government doesn't move so quick, you know that. And I think there were about 9 different members' bills actually that went through into the legislature that didn't pass before this one actually did. So do you think it was that NDP government that made it happen? So interestingly, it may not be the strongest piece piece of legislation, and some people do see some flaws with it. But before the EBR, there were no consultation requirements for any laws, regulations, policies, and there was no way to hold the government accountable for the decisions they made. So at least now we have a structured system in place for that. Also, in 1992 was the Earth Summit in Rio, and honestly, the principles behind the EBR sort of come from Principle 10 of the Rio Declaration. I'll let you read that. But it says that environmental issues are best handled with participation of all concerned citizens at the relevant level. At the national level, each individual shall have appropriate access to information concerning the environment that is held by public authorities, including information on hazardous materials and activities in their communities, and the opportunity to participate in decision-making processes. States shall facilitate and encourage public awareness and participation by making information widely available. Effective access to judicial and administrative proceedings, including redress and remedy, shall be provided. So they sort of pulled out some of these important points, and that is really what formulated the EBR. We've absolutely got judicial and proceedings to give us the right, and people have access to information in theory. Of course, if you don't have a computer, it's a little bit more challenging, because some of that information is definitely available online. So what they decided when they created the EBR is that the natural environment has inherent value. It's pretty interesting. Even in the States, somewhere down in the eastern states, there are some people trying to give the environment its own rights, really giving the earth rights. So this is not quite there, but that is interesting that some places are trying to do it and just say that you can't go disrupt the natural processes that exist in the earth. But we're not quite there. It is their responsibility to protect the environment, but we also have a means to participate and hold that government accountable. And theoretically, that's what we've got. So there is ability for us to have public participation, and it does start on the internet, and we'll go through that shortly. And we can take the polluters to court if we want to. It's written in the EBR that we can actually sue, take people to court. And anyone who decides to report their employer for environmental practices, pollution, they're protected. What would it mean to be a whistleblower and be protected? I'm not sure. Your employer can't punish you. They can hate you forever. So, I don't know what's the kind of a challenging one. Nonetheless, you can report them and they can't fire you. Okay, so the EBR covers 14 ministries and one agency. There's always more opportunity for different ministries to be prescribed. We can actually create an application and ask for a new ministry to be prescribed under the EBR if we feel that an important one isn't. For instance, the Ministry of Education. There have been some applications to ask that they be prescribed. I will say, though, that it's kind of in process now, so we might be seeing that within the next few years.
But it is in the curriculum, at least, as far as elementary school, because the grade 4s do have a task in communities, so it's there.
I know.
Every year,
and they have added it, you're right.
It's been there for about, 4 or 5 years, at least.
But to have them actually prescribed under the EBR would be more as well. I guess it's in the curriculum now, but are we saying this school needs to have more access to the environment? We want to have an application so that schools absolutely need wild spaces or naturalized habitat on the ground so that kids get to interact with nature, for instance.
Also, Gord Miller went to the OC conference in King, I think, at Seneca College,
yeah.
And I filmed that. I actually put it on YouTube. OC is the Teachers Federation for the Ecology.
Yeah, Environmental Education, yeah.
Yeah,
yeah, I was actually there too. Now, in this time, with the new protections in place, it would not be approved.
Right. No.
So he definitely did say that, yeah, and we just kept sharing what he said in some of the reports. And it's absolutely on here. Like, if you search for Site 41 here, you will find things from that was said by the commissioner. Yeah, you're right. And we've absolutely got cycled again and again, too, yeah. That's great. You can definitely ask the ministry to investigate. And the way this works is through our office, and it's explained in this EBR new booklet, you can get an application actually copies in there as well. But it's just an application for investigation. And yourself and one other person would fill it out as it asks for, explain the situation, the alleged contravention, what is the act being contravened, and what is the regulation perhaps being contravened, and then just fill it all out in detail. Include evidence that can be photographs, it can be dated video, it can be many different things. And once it's completed, you'd have to get these affidavits signed from the appropriate person, and then it gets sent in through our office, to our office, and then we forward it on to the appropriate ministry. We don't do investigations, but because we're watching what's going on, often the ministry will be very careful in what they're doing. And then we're also going to report on some of the more powerful things that go through, and it gets written up in here. So it's one way, if we think that the ministry is maybe ignoring one of the problems that they should be looking after, this is one way to get them to handle it. So then the other, the other EBR right is the right to request a review. And once again, if you think that maybe there's too many loopholes for industries to pollute, or you think that there's a totally missing law and you'd like to create a new law, you can actually ask for one to be created. This is really very interesting, because that is not something available anywhere else. The EBR is very unique, and I think that this one is very, very powerful, because it does happen that we can actually strengthen our laws and seal up some of these loopholes.
So that could affect things that we're not able to access to the Environmental Assessment Act, if we had, if she mentions that beaker plant in Bradford. We can't comment on that, but could you comment this way, that you think there's a process that has changed?
In a way, yes, because there are, if you go to our website as well, you can see which ministries are prescribed and which acts are prescribed. The Environmental Assessment Act is prescribed under the EBR. So it's prescribed for review and investigation. That's to say that someone could actually ask for a review of the EAA such that, you know, to somehow increase the comment or comment, and we've actually commented on it, especially in the 08 report, some of the weaknesses in the environmental assessment process, and that some people don't feel there's enough public input or enough public consultation, or people weren't aware of some of these projects going through. If there was a way to, for instance, strengthen that so that more people would be informed, or that I outlined these, create a stronger outline for ways that people need to be engaged and informed by the proponents before they move forward with a project. As a for instance example, I'm not saying that this is something that should be done, but that's like an example of how this could be used.
We talk about this at Transition all the time, that you don't want to reinvent the wheel. There's we talk about things we'd like to do, and then very quickly find out that it's already being done somewhere where we could help out with another group rather than trying to do it on our own. And rather than trying to do the same things over and over again to connect people together is hugely important. I know even in the city of Barrie, our mayor-elect has talked about having citizens group, and I've already talked to him about an environmental advisory group that would hopefully consist largely of people from the NGOs that have interest in various aspects or all of them. And I think that's very important at every level. And you're quite right. It is important groups, but we do need ways of getting people connected. And there was a lot of talk in the election about using social media. Well, that keeps coming up as a way for grassroots, low-budget groups to connect. Things like Facebook and just emails.
For April 1st, 2009 to March 31st, 2010. That's the reporting period for any given report. Comes out in the fall. And we talk about important government decisions that are made, and we talk about applications, and I'll explain what these applications are that we get from groups like yours. And then I'll talk a bit about some examples of, part of the work is driven by what the government does, part of the work is driven by what the citizens apply for or use their rights to apply for, and part of the work is what we call the developing issue, which are things that in the course of our duties with my staff and I find out things that maybe aren't being talked about, things that are important environmentally. So those sort of three elements combined and produce that report. But first, just to clarify, the first thing you've got to know about the Environment Commissioner's Office is just to understand the role. It's very unique. It's very unusual. As Marianne said, there's only two environmental commissioners in the world that report directly to Parliament, myself and the one from New Zealand.